Hey guys, and welcome back to our lecture series. I'm Ted, your host, and I'm here to give you another lecture. And for today's lecture, we're going to discuss John Adams and his presidency. But before we begin our lecture proper, I'd like to do our customary recap and just touch on the last two lectures that we had. We sort of broke with our traditional canon. Typically, we just discuss the events, not necessarily the people. In our last lecture, we looked at George Washington. We looked at him as a person, as a military commander, and as a president. And before that, we touched on the rise of party politics in the United States, and particularly the split between the anti-federalist and the pro-federalist that simply generated into the anti-federalist and a couple of the federalists forming the Democratic-Republican Party. Mainly to function at the opposition, the organized opposition to Alexander Hamilton and a program of social and economic policies in the early republic. And now, at this point, with Adams' election, the Federalist and the Democratic Republican, they are firmly established on the political scene. You are either a Federalist or you are a Democratic Republican. There really isn't a whole lot of middle ground between them. Adams was of course elected in the 1796 presidential election as the president, and Thomas Jefferson, as the runner-up, was awarded the office of vice president. And because the vice president serves as the president of the Senate, he becomes the second president of the Senate. And Adams is not the first choice for the Federalists in the presidential election. He is a second-hand candidate. He was really not really trusted by Hamilton and the other Federalists. He had a lot of conscionable acts that he had displayed throughout his time as vice president and even a political career before that, that really worried some of the higher-ups in the Federalist organization. And in Corp of Washington, discussing his life, we discussed his nature, his role as a slave owner, how he profited until the day he died from the labors of others, and he did not hesitate to coerce by force or by the implied threats to others or to the person themselves the return of runaway slaves. He posted numerous ads seeking the return of Oney Judge. He hired numerous slave catchers to return her. He attempted to very unsuccessfully woo Hercules or Herculas back to Mount Vernon, none of which succeeded. But he also did something that really no other senior Southern politician on the scene was willing to do, and that is he actually went through with manumitting his slaves, whether it was done beyond the grave or not. No one else really was willing to jump on that, so certainly not Jefferson or Madison, or even Monroe, if you want to look at it later on. Nobody was willing to really free their slaves. He actually did so. And he actually freed one slave outright in his will, Billy Lee. With Washington, we also looked at his inability to bridge the gap between Madison and Hamilton and how that sort of breakdown in relations really led to the really acrimonious political scene that will follow later on, particularly that would arise in today's lecture, Adams' presidency. And now with that being said, I'd like to jump straight into our lecture for today. And to begin with, I just want to say that John Adams had, up until his election, been one of the most distinguished Americans of his generation. Throughout the 1770s, 1780s and 1790s, very few of his contemporaries could match his service record. He rose from a small-time Massachusetts backcountry lawyer to literally being president of the United States. He had defended the British soldiers who were put on trial for their participation in the Boston shooting, also known as the Boston Massacre or the Boston Incident, that saw the deaths of multiple civilians, including Crispus Attucks. He denounced the Stamp Act way back in 1776. He has served on the Continental Congress from 1774 to 1778. He was actually the seconder of Richard Henry Lee's resolution for independence. And the seconder is simply the first person after you make your resolution, after you make your statement, to say that they support it and that they agree that this should be put to a vote, that this should be made legislation. So he seconded the resolution for independence. He served on the delegation sent to negotiate the Treaty of Paris in 1783. He continued his service to his country by becoming the first ambassador, or as it was known back then, a minister to the court of St. James, representing American interests in Great Britain and the United Kingdom after the Revolutionary War. And finally, he served as the first vice president and the first president of the United States Senate. But for all of his service, for all of his good deeds and real patriotism displayed to his nation, few people liked him in the United States. And in particular, Benjamin Franklin came to personally dislike him. At the time of his election, John Adams was 61 years old. He was a short, balding, tubby man who was a little headstrong to the point of vanity. He was very ardent in his beliefs. He even wrote a book in 1787 entitled A Defense of the Constitutions of the Government of the United States. This book really led to him being mistrusted and kind of just idly watched by Madison and later Jefferson. And Hamilton, as noted before, Hamilton disliked him because of his considerable actions. Even though Adams was a committed Federalist, he was at best a lukewarm supporter of Hamilton's program. He wasn't very enthusiastic about government regulations, government regulation of the economy. Didn't really care for protective tariffs or encouraging domestic manufacturing, or even a national bank. In fact, Adams, more than anything, was a very peculiar cross between what both parties wanted. He certainly believed in the necessity of a strong federal government, but he remained what Jefferson purported to be, and that is a country lawyer with a farm to manage. He had a lot in common with what both parties wanted to put out there. And really, looking at it from that point of view, he was really the best man for the situation in 1796. And again, he was only backed in 1796 because there was no other logical Federalist alternative who could reasonably defeat Thomas Jefferson in the election. The Federalists backed him, but they were not happy about it. And now that we've sort of covered all of his little backstory, let's dive right into what happened during his administration. And to begin with, we'd have to talk about foreign policy, because foreign policy dominated his administration. The first test of Adams's administration greeted him as soon as he came into office, and it came from the American sister republic of France. The French Revolution, which erupted so violently, had largely expended most of its energy by 1796. The Reign of Terror was over, having collapsed in the reaction of Thermidor. France was now being governed by a five-man board known as the Directory, who had the unappealing task of restoring the battered French Republic at home and abroad. At this time, France was still fighting off attack by the counter-revolutionary coalitions in Europe, headed by Austria, Prussia, Sardinia, Spain, and of course, Great Britain. The French expected the Americans to offer, if not military aid, then at least financial support and trade and sympathy for their situation. The French received neither. For the Americans, the young American Republic was totally dependent on seaborne commerce. The mid-Atlantic states and the New England states depended on the carrying trade, carrying the agricultural cash crop produced in the South to overseas market. If you anger Great Britain, who was the dominant sea power at the time, they would simply either seize your ships on the sea or enact simple blockades on your coastal ports, effectively ruining you. So the seaborne commerce that was the young American Republic lifeline was pitifully vulnerable to the British Navy. The British keenly aware of this, exploited the situation perfectly. In the winter of 1794, they began seizing American ships that they caught trading in the French West Indian ports. Washington and Hamilton preferred restraint over outright confrontation, which would have been suicidal for the young republic. The result was the hated Jay Treaty of 1795. The treaty was arguably the best that the American could have gotten given the international situation of the 1790s, but the Directory was understandably furious when they discovered the full details of the treaty. And the Directory resolved to take action to bring their sister republic back into line with force. They authorized open season on American shipping, with the intention being that they were going to use the French Navy to bring the Americans to their senses and renounce the Jay Treaty. And with renouncing the Jay Treaty, they will be restoring unrestricted American trade with the French Republic. And the French soon outpaced the British in seizures on the sea. And this was the situation that Adams walked into after his inauguration. Now, Adams was ready to fight. He called a special session of Congress to make ready for war, but he also decided to open negotiations with the French. And in July of 1797, he sent a delegation consisting of Charles Cosworth Pinckney, John Marshall, and Elbridge Gerry to meet with the Directory in Paris. Now, the negotiations were a dismal failure. Their appointment to meet with the Directory was repeatedly shelved. And for weeks, they were simply just kept around waiting, being told that they're next. No appointment, no interview ever materialized. They were finally granted an audience with the French Foreign Minister, Charles Maurice Talleyrand, who, after a very brief meeting with the Americans, sent personal agents of his to imply to them that a donation of $240,000 would make their mission much easier. The agents also told the Americans that the United States would have to agree to loans to the French that equaled about $10 million to atone for the bad behavior of the Americans, namely, you know, signing the Jay Treaty. The American response was best summed up by Pinckney, who simply shouted, "No, no, no, not a sixpence." And so after a further 6 weeks of simply milling around in France with nothing to do, they announced their departure and demanded their passports. Now, Adams received their report, and he sent an edited version to Congress, who were only fully informed of the events in France once the men were safely on their way back home. Now, the XYZ Affair, as it came to be known, really rallied the people around Adams and the Federalist Party. Congress duly abrogated all of the Franco-American treaties dating all the way back to Revolutionary War's 1778 Treaty of Commerce and Amity. Congress then authorized the seizure of French ships, a national direct tax on property to raise an additional $2 million for war preparations. And really, what followed was known as the Quasi War or the Quasi War. And it was really just an undeclared naval war between the United States and France. And during this time, over 70 French ships were captured. And the American frigate, Constellation, actually fought and captured the French frigate Algernon and battered the Vengeance all the way down, it literally just left it a mess of a hull. The $2 million that he asked Congress for to raise money for was actually put to use raising a land force of 12,500 men. That force was assembled into 12 regiments of infantry and 6 regiments of dragoons. Now, Washington at the time was brought out of retirement and given command as a lieutenant general in this army that was raised to meet any sort of French invasionary force. With Hamilton, much to the anguish of both the Democratic Republicans and Adams, Hamilton was brought in to serve as Washington's major general. The war fever was great for the Federalists, who witnessed an unbelievable surge in popularity. Now, Adams was really for the first time popular with his own countrymen. And the Federalists, but Adams and the Federalists, however, they really didn't use this opportunity to the fullest. They could have used this opportunity to outright destroy Madison, Jefferson, and all the other Democratic Republicans. They didn't. John Adams displayed the most alarming trait that he had, that trait that gave Hamilton such uneasiness about him. And that was his conscionable acts. Adams and the Federalists, from this point on, they would simply hand over all the goodwill that they had garnered from the people back to the Democratic Republicans. As a matter of fact, at the end of all this, the Democratic Republicans would regain their reputation as the defenders of American liberty, and they would also take away from the Federalists the title of geniuses of foreign policy. And the way all of this was accomplished was that in the hysteria that ensued with the Quasi War and all these thoughts, talks and beliefs of, you know, theories of just going to war with France, Hamilton and the Federalists in Congress managed to push through a series of acts, four congressional acts, known collectively as the Alien and Sedition Acts. And these acts were really meant to really just ensure that the Federalists retained control of the national government, but they were also meant to really just keep the populace in line. And the first of these acts was the Naturalization Act. Now, the Naturalization Act extended the time it took for an alien to become a citizen. It expanded the time from 5 years to 14 years, and it was aimed at keeping political power out of the hands of immigrants, namely French immigrants. But really, in particular, it was aimed at keeping political power out of the hand of the Madisonian, Jeffersonian, Democratic, Republican-leaning immigrants. The surface logic was to ensure that the immigrant was duly invested in the United States before granting citizenship. But everyone could clearly see that if you supported Hamilton, Adams, and the Federalists, you would be bothered. But if you opposed them, you were going to be targeted. The second two, the middle two, the second and the third, the Act Concerning Aliens and the Act Concerning Alien Enemies, were two acts that gave the president sweeping powers against those in the United States who were still only aliens by permitting their arrest and deportation if they were suspected of secret or treasonous leanings. Now, the intention, and this is coming directly from the sponsor, Harrison Gray Otis, was, and this is again using the language of the time, the intention was that we do not invite hordes of Irishmen, nor the turbulent and disorderly of all other parts of the world, with a view to disturb our tranquility after having succeeded in the overthrow of their own governments. And basically all that meant was immigrants were now unnoticed. If immigrants came to the United States and did anything that the people in power didn't like, they did anything that other American citizens didn't like, they can be sent back home on a moment notice by order of the president. And something else that was really striking about the two acts was that treason and treasonous activities for the aliens was never really fully defined. It was really unclear what the exact definition of both of those were. Normally treason would be doing something that that was against the national interest of your country, your government. But for the aliens, it could have been as simple as simply saying, wow, John Adams is messing up. Wow, I don't know what Alexander Hamilton is doing. And that would have been enough to garner a deportation. And now the last of the four acts was the Sedition Act, which dealt with native-born malcontents. And now the Sedition Act established heavy fines and prison terms, actually, for writing, speaking, or publishing anything false, scandalous, or malicious about the president or members of Congress, but not the vice president. Remember, the vice president is Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson isn't a Federalist. You have something bad you want to say about him. You have a lie you want to say about him. Go ahead. Go for it. No one's going to bother you. This act, very clearly, it was no veil about it, no nothing about it. This act very clearly was meant to target the Madisonian, Jeffersonian, Democratic Republicans. As a matter of fact, William Duane, a Madisonian Democratic Republican from Pennsylvania, was indicted for libel. His indictment was overturned but reinstated, and it will go all the way up to the Senate before being quashed by the Senate. Jedediah Peck is another guy. Jedediah Peck was a Federalist from New York who opposed these acts. He was actually a justice of the peace. He was brought up on charges of seditious libel and brought all the way to New York City for trial. About 30 people were arrested under these acts. But instead of the acts tempering the malcontents, they merely exacerbated the situation. It convinced a lot of Americans that Hamilton, Adams, and the other Federalists were simply going off the deep end. They really didn't know how to respond to this. Madison and Jefferson, they were not idle during this time. They very clearly saw what was being done to them and their supporters. And they drew up their own responses to these new Federalist acts, which were adopted by the heavily Democratic Republican legislatures of Kentucky and Virginia. Now, the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions, the resolutions, they allowed Adams and the other Federalists to be criticized without any reprisals to the legislators or the authors. No one was going to arrest or indict the entire legislature of the states of Virginia and Kentucky. It allowed for Madison and Jefferson to voice their opposition and to state their opposition and to try to garner support. Both resolutions, invoked hollow American principles to denounce the Alien and Sedition Acts. The resolutions outlined point blank that the states, utilizing the 10th Amendment, would be able to take it upon themselves to nullify any federal legislation. And in particular, James Madison even hinted at secession from the federal union. This is the first time that anyone ever mentioned secession from the federal union, but Madison does it himself in his resolution. Jefferson and Madison, after the adoption of the resolutions by Kentucky and Virginia, they called on the legislatures of all the other states to endorse the Kentucky and Virginia resolutions. None of the other states did so, much to the chagrin of Jefferson and Madison. In fact, the Federalists in Congress fought off all attempts by the Democratic Republicans to have the Alien and Sedition Acts repealed. Madison and Jefferson, however, they didn't really view this as a major defeat for them. They saw the writing on the wall. They understood the long view, that the mass hysteria over France would abate. It would go away after some time. And that the artificial support that the Federalists and Adams enjoyed would wither away when the hysteria abated. And the French soon, proved that. The French soon preoccupied themselves with other matters, as the United States was on the other side of the world, and contesting Great Britain was always their main objective. The French seized an opportunity to go and capture Egypt, and in the process cut off the British access to India. In the ensuing campaign, in the ensuing Egyptian campaign, the British, under Horatio Nelson, were able to just smash the French fleet really just smashed into pieces at the Battle of Aboukir Bay. And with that defeat, the Egyptian campaign came to a swift and sudden end. With that defeat, the Directory collapsed. And in the wake of his failure, during the Egyptian campaign, Napoleon Bonaparte was able to walk back in to the French political scene and simply orchestrate a coup d'etat against the Directory and establish himself as First Consul of the French Republic. And with the French threat dissipating, the reasonable need to be on guard from foreign subversives ended. And no sooner had Napoleon had himself named First Consul than Congress began to become inundated by the angry petitions from American citizens calling on the immediate demobilization of the army and the repeal of all the Alien and Sedition Acts. Adams's subsequent decision to reopen negotiations with France outraged Hamilton and the other Federalists. They understood as well that they could ride the emotional wave of the American citizens by simply fabricating or creating foreign crises. They can use that to keep their enemies at bay. They can use that to simply hold on to power. But Adams's conscionable actions kick into play at this point, and Adams decides to reopen negotiations with France. Hamilton, the other Federalists, are outraged. He was derided for frittering away his party's main political card. And in response to Adams' decision to reopen negotiations with France, Hamilton decided to mount a dump Adams campaign for the 1800 election. He wanted to find a more pliable candidate. He wanted to find another Washington, someone who would have ideas of their own but can be easily persuaded to adopt, you know, what was in the best interest of the party, as Hamilton saw it. And Hamilton did this knowing full well that the Democratic Republicans were going to be running Jefferson again as their presidential candidate in the 1800 election. And he did it also knowing that only complete party uniformity will be able to defeat Jefferson. Only if all of the Federalists stood like ducks in a line and backed Adams would they be able to retain control of the national government, retain control of the presidency. Hamilton just wasn't having it. At every step, at every turn, he was there to undermine Adams. With the divided House, the Federalists easily fell to the Democrats. Well, not easily. Adams was able to pull 65. He was able to pull 65 electoral votes. He very nearly won again. You know, he just edged out slightly. But he was edged out, and the Federalists fell to the Democratic Republicans, who sailed rather uneasily themselves into office. Now, Jefferson had won the race over Adams, and was really a repeat of the 1796 election, but he also tied with Aaron Burr of New York for the most electoral votes. Now, the state electors at this time, they were given 2 votes for president, and now the top vote getter, as we already discussed, would receive the presidency, and the runner-up would receive the vice presidency. Well, both Burr and Hamilton had the same exact number of electoral votes. One was going to be president, one was going to be vice president. Now, the Democratic-Republican plan was to have Jefferson the president, Burr had vice president. They all expected Burr to simply, you know, accept that. Well, Burr was the John Adams. Aaron Burr was the John Adams of the Democratic Republican Party. He only joined the party because he had a deep hatred of Alexander Hamilton. They contested with each other for control of New York State. So he really wasn't too gung-ho about anything that Jefferson or Madison was really into. He was much more just looking out for himself. And now that he had a chance to be president, He went on this wonderful pitch campaign to convince everybody that they should back him, that they should give him the job, that they should allow him to be president, that he had a great and fantastic future for the United States mapped out. Burr had the distinction of being more distrusted and more hated by the Federalists, and particularly by Hamilton, than by the other Democratic Republicans. But Burr also had his own network of supporters. And when he decided that he really wanted to be president, when he mobilized his entire efforts, it was quite substantial. Hamilton, Madison, and Jefferson found that there were quite a number of people willing to back him in this endeavor. It took, with the election being contested, it was sent to the House of Representatives, and it took 35 votes in the House of Representatives, with neither candidate being able to gain a majority, with no decision being made. After 35 votes, Hamilton, in exacerbation, walked in, gave a speech in which he denounced Burr on the floor of the House, really to the shock of everybody. And Madison, Jefferson, Burr, all of the major players were there. Hamilton denounced him, said don't vote for him, let it be known that they will be able to work with Madison and Jefferson and whoever else they want to bring in with the incoming administration, that it will be better to let the Democratic Republicans have a go at it than to let Burr have at it. He said that if you let Burr get inside there, he will simply destroy it. So on the 36th vote, Jefferson was awarded the office of president. And with that, we'll end our lecture with the end of the disputed election of 1800, with Hamilton walking into the Senate and handing over really the reins of government to his great opponents, Madison and Jefferson, and denouncing Burr, something that we will revisit later in the future, in future lectures. Now with Jefferson's election, the Democratic Republicans were now preparing to step up and brush aside everything that the Federalists had done. But it's easier to look on the outside wanting to change than to actually be inside, viewing events as they unfold. And with that, we'll end our lecture, and we'll now simply brush into our recap. So in today's lecture, we discussed the XYZ Affair, how the Americans were really discovering firsthand the sort of rough and tumble world of international diplomacy. France, who had been their great ally really up until this point, was now becoming their great enemy, or becoming the great dreaded foe. Things escalated from the XYZ Affair to the Quasi War, in which the United States fought an undeclared naval war with France, and finally into the Alien and Sedition Acts, in which the Federalists went on a sort of a rampage and began to enact all of these really restrictive acts in an effort to, one, break the immigrant party, the immigrants who came in to support the Democratic Republicans. And then we also saw the Democratic Republican response to the Alien and Sedition Acts, the Virginia and Kentucky resolutions. We saw how they were easily passed in Kentucky and Virginia, but really didn't garner a lot of support outside of those two states. And we also see in the resolutions, and particularly from Madison's point of view, that the states could secede from the Union. So we had the principle of secession now being expressed by Madison and his anger and his frustration over the Alien and Sedition Acts and the unbridled use of power, I guess we can say, by Hamilton and the Federalists. And most importantly, in this lecture, we see the defeat of the Federalist Party in the 1800 election. All right. And now we'll end here. And when we come back for our next lecture, We'll discuss what happened after 1800. We'll discuss the events of the first term of Thomas Jefferson. And as always, I'm Ted. And I'll see you guys for another lecture. And as always, like, subscribe, and comment. Let me know what you thought about Adams's presidency.